Hey, welcome back to day three. Holy, we're already here. We're halfway through. Now, let me ask you, after looking at those ego states, are you starting to think about who you are? Are you starting to think about who other people are? Are we starting to look for those parental and those childlike behaviors? Look, what's really great about ego states is not only does it give us the understanding of self, but it starts to give us the understanding of others. And that's what we're getting into today. So far what we covered yesterday was all about your personality. Now, if you have this personality, if you have these ego states, a parent, adult, child, guess what? So do other people. And today we're going to talk a little bit about transactions. And there are three types of transactions. Today's transaction we're going to talk about is something called the predictable transaction. Now, what is a predictable transaction? A predictable transaction is exactly what it sounds like. It is a predictable transaction. It's predictable in outcome. I can predict, I could be a fortune teller, I could be a mind reader in some capacity of how this person's going to respond. Now, here's what's really crappy about today. After today's session, you can no longer get away with the excuse of it was them. Because what we learned today is we have to take complete responsibility for the interaction. In a lot of cases, we can control is actually a bad word, but we can contribute to the other person responding as the adult. You see, where all of these things go wrong is not just the personality, but the delivery. Think about how many times someone has actually spoken to you in a specific way that's put you into that angry child. Maybe it was at work where you weren't able to overtly respond, so you had to swallow that. And that's where we became the covert child. So what helps us understand predictable transactions? It's a very simple acronym called PRAT. Now, PRAT is a brilliant, brilliant, brilliant acronym. It is so simple, and it's something that I could use in the moment. In fact, I've got a story about PRAT. It's a little bit of an out there story, but I promise you, I've been telling you this story for the last 20 years. 20 years ago, I came out of a bar, and it was a Saturday night. And back then, before Ubers and before, you know, all this easy transportation, you had to flag down a cab on Saturday night. Now, in a lot of cases, getting a cab on a Saturday night outside of a club or a bar was like survival of the fittest. It was like the jungle where, you know, you had to like climb over people, you had to fight your way through cabs. And again, it was really survival of the fittest, specifically if it was around 2 a.m. in the morning. So fast forward the conversation, we're at a bar, I'm there with a few friends, and it's closing time. And of course, I am also a nurturing parent. My buddies say, hey, Wits, go get some cabs. So I'm like, cool. So I go outside. Now, at this point, I'm in Toronto, Canada, and it's probably about February. And if you've ever been to Toronto in February, it's freaking cold. It could be like minus 30, minus 40, snow up to your eyeballs, ice everywhere. I don't even know how people live in this type of weather. So I'm outside, I'm standing on the sidewalk, and of course I've had a few drinks that night. So as they say, you've had a few drinks, you get a little wobbly. In fact, you could even picture, you know, those big sort of blow up sort of balloon men that usually sit outside of an automobile dealership. I was kind of like that on the sidewalk. Anyway, what happened next was one in a million shot. I'm standing on the sidewalk, I'm looking for a cab, I'm a little wobbly, and a car comes driving by, and it must be driving by pretty fast. I'm going to say up to about 100 kilometers an hour, maybe about 60 miles an hour. And as I'm wobbling down, I sort of lean back, my foot comes up, and what happened next was one in a million. My foot connects with his side view mirror and kicks it clean off. Now, you gotta understand, this happens so quickly that at one point I turned around to look at a building behind me because I thought someone threw something off a balcony. And as I'm looking here, I hear, and this car comes to a screaming halt. Now, at this point, I'm thinking two things. I'm thinking, one, I'm glad he stopped, we'll talk this out. But I'm actually not thinking that. What I'm really thinking is, thank goodness I got all my boys with me, because if this guy wants to get out and go down, I got a crew of guys with me. So this car comes screeching back, reversing. The door flies open, and I swear to you, a monster unveils himself from the car. This was not a small person. This dude was like the size of a giant. He was a Mack truck getting out the car. And he gets out the car with the club. And the club, for some of you that don't know, this was what back in the day you used to lock your steering wheel with so people couldn't steal your car. And he gets out, and I'll never forget the sound. And he pulls the club apart, he comes charging at me, and he says, mother effer, you're effing dead. Now, this is a story of PRAT, people respond as treated. Now, like we're gonna cover a little bit tomorrow, my primitive brain kicks in, and my flight or fight response kicks in. Now my fight response kicks in, but here's the problem. This is a Mack truck. This dude looked like he just got out of prison. This dude looks like I could hit him with a 2x4 and it wouldn't even faze him. So I'm now thinking I gotta run. And at this point I'm thinking, oh my gosh, if I run and he starts chasing me, you don't wanna run from a bear, right? You wanna sort of stand there and sort of, you know, just hold your position. And the side door opens and his girlfriend or wife or friend gets out the car and she's going, no, 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 not again, Johnny, not again. Now I'm thinking, what do you mean not again? Now you gotta understand, this is happening so quickly. And I turn around and I look for my friends, and if you've ever seen those Disney movies, in fact, maybe we'll use the Smurfs as an example, you know, the big bad character Gargamel comes along and all the Smurfs or the little trolls, they go dancing into the forest and, you know, they hide under everything and they disappear. It's exactly what happened to my friends that night. Now at this point, I have this moment of clarity. Pratt, people respond as treated. This guy thinks I kicked his mirror off, I'm standing on the side of the car, all I gotta do is communicate to his adult. I can't communicate to his child, I can't run, I can't fight, I can't tell him to stop because that's just gonna aggravate the situation, but if I can ask him a question, if I could get his frontal lobe, his intelligent brain processing, I could get him to pause because I don't wanna get hit. Again, I'm thinking, oh my gosh, this guy's gonna kill me. Fast forward the conversation. I step forward and I say, may I ask you to stop? And he literally stopped. And then I use the second question because the adult ego state communicates through questions, if you remember. I said, would you believe me if I told you this was a complete fluke and a complete accident? And I swear this was like slow motion watching his hands drop. And I asked the third question. I said, would you believe me if I told you, again, I repeated the question, this was a complete accident? Fourth question, right? Did you think I was trying to kick the mirror off your car? Fifth question, what are the chances of that actually happening? Now, by this point, we're flowing and we're talking, we exchange information, I tell him to go get a quote, we're gonna pay for the mirror, no problem. At this point, all my boys walk out, they're like, hey, what's going on? I'm like, way to go, guys, perfect timing. And we leave that night, we've exchanged information, and he calls me 3 days later to meet him. He's got the quote, and of course at this point I'm thinking, I don't want to meet this guy in my office, I don't want to meet him around my house. This guy literally looked again like he got out of prison, big head, goatee, tattoos everywhere, and back then tattoos were not as cool as they are today. Like if you had tats, you were a pretty scary individual. So I meet him at a coffee shop and I come out, I meet him in the parking lot, and as I pull up and I get out the car, again, this monster unveils himself. But this time he's a little more friendly. He rolls up and he's more like the jolly giant at this point. And he's like, hey man, nice to see you, blah, blah, blah. And I'll never forget the amount I had to pay him. $317.43 was the check that I wrote for him. And as I'm giving him the check, as he showed me the quote, he said to me, I just want to thank you. And I thought, what do you mean you want to thank me? He was like, you have no idea. I was going to murder you that night. And at this point, I'm thinking, well, okay, well, this is getting a little freaky and creepy. He's like, you don't understand. However you handled that situation, I don't know what you did, but it got me to calm down and you saved my life, you saved my career, and you saved my relationship. At this point, I asked him, what does he do? Now, he worked for a government agency, which I won't mention exactly where, but part of his job was he was an undercover agent and he would bust drug runners. He would run stings, and that's part of why his character was what it was. And I asked him another question. I said, why are you in this government agency right now? And he said part of his career track is to get into policing, and he's using this agency as a launching pad into policing. And he said, if I had struck you that night, first of all, I don't know if I would have stopped because I was so angry. I was just seeing pure red in the moment. But my career would have been finished. My marriage would have ended. My life would have ended. And I thank you for handling it. And he said, what do you do for a living? And I said, well, I teach communication skills. And at that point, we exchanged. I gave him the check, shook his hand, and I walked off. And I've been telling this story around Pratt, people respond as treated, for the last 20 years. Now, let's just actually break this down for a second. What is the psychology of Pratt? Again, I have a parent, adult, and a child. And back to the story, this guy had a parent, adult, child. And what he did was as he came at me, I said, I just gotta communicate to his adult, because if I can get him an adult, people respond as treated, if I speak to his adult, if I ask him those questions, if I get him thinking, then guess what? He's gonna start to respond. And the ultimate communication path is a adult to adult. This is what facilitates understanding. This is what supports comfort. Now, if this works, if Pratt works in a severe situation, outside of the office, think about how this is gonna work when you're at work, when you're trying to move your career ahead, when you need to have a difficult discussion, when you're arguing with your significant other, when you're trying to speak to your children, when you're trying to speak to a client, when you're the client and you're trying to call customer service. Think about customer service for a second. If you've ever called customer service, you haven't spoken to them like the adult. You've either fired at their child because you were frustrated in the moment, so your angry child was going, or you are hammering them through your parents on what you expected. And this is why customer service is so difficult, because the way we speak to that representative, that agent, is like a child, and we're expecting them to respond like the adult. So here is the lesson for today. People respond as treated. It works in every single interaction. As soon as you are finding yourself in a conversation that's not going well, I want you to take a moment and start to ask yourself, who am I and who am I speaking to? Now, like I said, I wanna give you a few things this week that you're immediately able to implement, and Pratt is one of them. It has saved my life, it's saved my career, it's part of why I'm able to be effective as a leader, as a father, as a friend, as a husband, right, and as a peer. People respond as treated. And in all moments when I'm thinking, oh my gosh, why is this going the way it's going, I fall back to Pratt. What just happened in the transactions? So here's what we've covered so far this week. You figured out a little bit about who you are from an ego state, and now we're figuring out a little bit about who they are. And the rules are, the more we use questions, the more effective we can be communicating to the adult. All right, I hope you found today interesting, helpful, informative, guiding, forwarding, and hopefully you're now starting to think about some of those interactions that maybe you need to take more responsibility for, and maybe you need to go back and say, hey, you know that conversation we had the other day? First, I want to apologize because it actually didn't go well, not because of you, but because of me. The ultimate way to communicate, the ultimate success you have in communication, is knowing the fact that you can contribute to the other person being the adult. All right, I've got some reference materials for you for today's lesson. Just a one pager, very easy to download. Check it out. And again, I will see you tomorrow.